Thanks, Craig. I get this from P1 Dave. He says that he heard us talking about Nate Bargatze, Dave, who is Craig's new favorite stand-up. And he had a great Saturday Night Live that has the classic George Washington sketch about how he's going to start this country and just make it the most confusing country ever by having our system of weights and measurements make no sense and, you know, skewering what we do here. Anyway, Dave says that he's been friends with Nate's dad for 23 years, and they meet up for magic sessions from time to time because Nate's dad is a magician. Would that be weird to have your dad be a magician and a clown?
Yeah.
He said when he first met Nate, he said to him, "I was thinking that there's no way that you're as funny as your dad, but you're funnier than your dad." So Nate's dad's really funny, too.
Okay.
He said, "Nate's truly a kind guy. I remember when he was grinding it out and no one knew him, and he hasn't changed much. He's a good guy from a great family." That's good to hear.
Yeah.
You like hearing that. P1 Bert says he would love, he's got a bit request. He would love to hear Greg Olson narrate and broadcast an interactive shot put competition between George, Craig, and Fernando. I don't know why he left me out of it. Why can't I participate and talk? I don't know. I don't understand why. But yeah, a shot put competition. Thanks for your comedy consideration. Signed, Bert Maverick, Buck's cousin. Buck's cousin. We haven't heard from Buck Maverick in a while.
Maybe today, 8:40.
And then P1 Kirsten says, "Hey, Gordon, I heard the corner, I think it was yesterday, day before, about Chuck E. Cheese and the kids not caring about animatronics." That was yesterday, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
"I wanted to give some insight because kids are obsessed with them in my experience," she says. "My son is 3 and recently became enamored with animatronics, specifically the scary Halloween ones. He wants to learn how to make them and is asking for animatronics only for Christmas and his birthday."
Hmm.
"We went to a variety of stores this recent Halloween season, no less than 30 times, and I'm not exaggerating, just to look at and play with the animatronics." I can't imagine taking a 3-year-old to those,
some of those really
Halloween
scary
stores.
Ones.
Yeah, because they're really creepy. But anyway, he loved them. And she says there was dozens of kids in there around her son's age or a little bit older doing the same thing. They even saw a son and a father duo multiple times at the same store on any given weekend playing with the animatronics.
Huh.
She says, "Now that Halloween's over, the only thing my kid wants to do is watch YouTube videos about building animatronics and trying to create things using them that he finds around the house. The fascination didn't come from Five Nights at Freddy's," because she hasn't obviously shown him any of that, "but animatronics are definitely a big deal for kiddos nowadays." And then she included a picture of her son creating his own animatronic with a skull head and a towel and trying to make that. Well, stand corrected. Some kids like animatronics.
Yeah.
But I'm telling you,
they'd be creeped out by them.
Did you guys go to a Halloween store this Halloween?
No.
By any chance?
No.
I did. I go every Halloween, and I'm always traumatized by it.
And yet you go.
I know.
I don't think I've ever been.
I'm fascinated and repulsed by them.
I've been to a Christmas store, but I've never been to a Halloween store.
You talk about the one that just like rents out a place for a couple of months, and
they rent out some big vacant store. There must be some money in that. Because that company that does it, I guess there's only one of them, right?
I don't know. Yeah.
Who's behind that company? What's going on there?
Which part of it? The leasing out or just the company that
just
takes over
the
space
pop-up
for
Halloween store is interesting to me. I wonder if it's a company that also runs pop-up Christmas stores. And will we start having pop-up Easter stores?
Maybe.
How to change your personality. Organ transplants and blood transfusions. Last year, 4,600 people in Britain received organ transplants, and nearly 200,000 gallons of blood were given in transfusions. And scientists are starting to ask if something very unexpected is happening as a result of all these organs and bloods being transmitted from one person to another, transplanted. It's memory. Does our memory get infused into our cells? And then when you put those cells into a new body, does it change their personality?
Wow.
This sounds crazy, but there have been a lot of stories of people who have had organ transplants, and they start describing how their personality changes and that they develop tastes that they never had before. There was a woman here in the U.S., a 47-year-old woman. She had a lung transplant from an 18-year-old, and then all of a sudden she just wanted nothing but beer and fried chicken, she said. Those were the two things that she loved.
Yes,
junk
science.
Food that she didn't normally like. And the Journal of American Medical Association, they found that patients who received blood from donors who later had recurring brain hemorrhages were more than twice as likely to suffer one themselves. So if Whoa. You get it from... So you can see how maybe something like that would be associated, but how does personality...
Wow, that is wild.
...transfer... Yeah, the researchers in this case of a study that was done by Geneva University, they interviewed seven people who received blood transfusions, and they found that three of the seven felt that their personalities had significantly changed. One said that he slept and dreamed a lot more than before. Another one said that his sense of taste has changed, which he found worrying, and he said, quote, "I hope that the donor's blood cannot take over."
Very
completely take over. And a third patient reported that after the transfusion, he was a lot happier and stronger than he ever was before. There's this new branch of study that's called cellular memory that they're trying to figure out, that personality transference can possibly occur in the wake of organ transplants or blood transfusions.
It all goes back to the cell.
Yeah. That's information is stored in there.
Now, some of this could be psychosomatic. You have new blood in your body, and you just are thinking that everything is changing, and so you've convinced yourself that you have a different sense of taste.
That's what they're trying to figure out, if indeed this is psychosomatic or whether it seems to not be fully explained by that.
That would be wild if you could actually change your personality by getting blood from someone who had a good personality.
So, is this a way, you know how when a woman's female wants to get a sperm donation, she browses through a book and she selects someone that has the characteristics that she would want for her babby?
Yes.
Can we start doing that now? We go into the blood transfusion place and look at what personality traits we'd like to get, and so we get our blood changed out.
Nobody likes you as a person, so you go to that catalog and you pick out Tom Hanks' blood.
Yeah, because I want Tom Hanks' personality. Or I want Michael Johnson's blood because I want to be able to run real fast, like he can. I think that'd be awesome. You could go into the market of, I'm going to start donating my blood for people who just want to kill it on local radio every day, just being so great.
Radio superstar coming through.
I mean, really dominating AM radio on the very upper end of the dial. I mean, that, you know, there's a lot of people who have that as a dream.
Sure.
So.
That's wild.
Yeah. 629. Bye.
Boom! Yeah!
Okay, bye.
Hit it, baby.
First time for everything.
All right, that's the O-Deck.
Thank you, Craig. One of the sorriest things I've ever heard of. 22-year-old woman is facing manslaughter charges in the wrong-way crash that killed one person and severely injured another one. This happened Friday, November 10th. When was that? The past Friday?
Yeah.
Yeah, this past Friday at 2:30 p.m. It happened on 635 near State Highway 161. And she was in this Nissan Altima, traveling eastbound in the westbound lanes of 635. Yeah. And at first she was traveling on the right shoulder, the wrong way, on the right shoulder. then swerved into oncoming traffic when the crash happened. They initially thought that she was intoxicated, but during a second interview with police, the 22-year-old woman named Diamond Brown admitted that the crash was intentional because she was trying to end her own life. So she crashed headfirst into another vehicle at 88 miles per hour.
Oh, my gosh. And somebody else's or a group of people.
Yeah, that's... She was going 88. That's not even accounting for the other vehicle that's traveling the opposite direction, however fast they were going.
Wow.
So, yeah, she ended up killing the passenger in that vehicle and the driver of the other vehicle. Suffered several broken bones and was hospitalized.
That's remarkable that they survived, that somebody could survive that.
I know it. It goes to show you that. And she survives.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I don't get. If she's trying to kill herself, was she wearing a seatbelt? Why would she crash headfirst into something if she's wearing a seatbelt? Now, I don't know whether it doesn't say in the story whether she was or not, but you would assume if she survived it, she must have been wearing a seatbelt.
I've always had the same thought about people who jump off a building to kill themselves. They could land on somebody down on the sidewalk or the street. Why take somebody else out?
I don't know.
Kind of sound like Greg Olson there.
I don't. Oh, you know, KB, I just don't know the answer to that. When someone jumps off a building and they splat.
Jeez. Greg.
She's been charged with manslaughter and aggravated assault with a deadly weapon for recklessly driving her vehicle into oncoming traffic. Why is it not murder again?
Good question.
Because that you have to have intent to kill somebody, but can't you show that if there is a reasonable outcome of this action would be the death of another person? How is that not murder?
Yeah, I don't get that.
Right, you are knowing there's somebody else driving that other car.
Like if I say to you, Craig, I'm just going to teach you a lesson, I'm going to shoot you in the head, but I'm going to try to just graze your scalp, mm-hmm. and it accidentally goes through your forehead, would they say, well, that's more manslaughtery, you know? Because, I mean, I was having a projectile go straight at you, which is what a car is.
Right. There should be a category called reckless murder.
Okay.
Something like that, more serious than manslaughter, reckless mm-hmm. murder. You knew you were going to kill a person, not that specific person. You didn't intend to kill Jane Doe. But you knew you were going to kill a person with your reckless behavior.
Right.
And that should be as serious a charge as murder.
Like when someone plows into a crowd, when we've seen these, you know, parades and someone goes crazy with their vehicle and then just runs the vehicle through the crowd. Don't they get charged with murder for that?
I swore
they did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, and maybe they'll change this charge against this woman. Anyway, that happened in Mesquite there, right? No, Irving. What am I saying?
Yeah.
What am I talking
635
about?
635 and 161. That's the bush, right?
Yeah.
Careful.
What?
So to speak.
Just everybody be careful.
All right.
I know this station, and I know this station cannot handle certain terms and words.
Tyler. Like what?
The ticket.
A man was arrested on suspicion of manslaughter. This is a very weirdly worded statement. Okay, now wait a second. Just hear me out. A man was arrested on suspicion of manslaughter in the death of former NHL player Adam Johnson.
Oh, yeah, I saw this.
The very notorious case that happened in England where a hockey player gets cut in the neck with a skate, and, of course, he dies because the neck has some very, very, some of the most important vessels for blood. And he died. And right after it happened, I remember someone floated out there, you know, the way that the other player... lifted his leg way up in the air to hit the guy in the neck. And
very strange.
Someone raised their head and said that, and I swore that the world shouted them down. How dare you? He's also a victim here because what he's going through emotionally. And then now it turns out that a man was arrested on suspicion of manslaughter.
A man.
But it says the man whose identity was not released by the police remains in custody.
Can't we just get a roster for that team?
I don't know. Well, the player whose skate cut Johnson's neck was Matt Petgrave.
Isn't that who they arrested?
A 31-year-old who plays for Sheffield. That's what I'm saying. Why is the story put out that they have not released the name of the person who was arrested?
I don't know. It was a very unnatural hockey move, what that guy did to lift his leg
and
raise the skate that high.
I think that they've dug up other footage. It seems like I saw other footage of the guy doing that same maneuver that didn't result, obviously in death. But of him, when he gets upended, he tries to, create a little maximum damage to the other team.
Jeez.
Not wanting to cut the neck necessarily, but at least kick someone.
Wow.
But arrested on manslaughter charges. NHL Vice President of Hockey Operations, Rod Pasma, he says that he's got, I think, 8 companies, he said, that are offering neck protection and everything, and they're trying to certify it in the NHL, and that any players who want to wear these neck guards and stuff, he says, we're going to fast-track the approval. You can go ahead and start wearing them, and we're going to get this stuff certified. So if players are concerned about it, and that's always interesting to me how it's for the player's protection, but a lot of players, at least with other protective gear in the past, seem
to
not
want
to
wear it. Yeah. If they want to wear it on their own, that's one thing, but they don't want to be, have it regulated to where you have to wear it?
Right.
Yeah.
But I'm saying, even the NHL is saying, we're not requiring you to wear this, but you can wear this. We will approve all this stuff. And why would a guy choose not to do it then? Is he just playing the odds?
Well, some will argue comfort, that they'll overheat if they have something wrapped around their neck. Others just do it to look tougher. That's why a lot of them resisted the helmets and then the shields. And so there's a little machismo thing playing in there.
And maybe it's a new thing, so it distracts them the first time they wear it, and they go, I hate that.
Yeah.
They don't really take the time to get used to it because they feel like they're under such pressure to perform, they don't have time to get used to it or something. But he says, that NHL Vice President of Hockey Operations, he said to the players, he said, if you think something's too hot to wear, if you think it's too heavy, you need to look at these current options. He said there are a lot of products that come on the market even in the last year that he feels will address those concerns for players if they have them.
If I had to play an NHL game, I'd look like an old-fashioned knight. I'd be in this suit of armor out there.
I would, if I was like a center, or I don't know the positions.
That's fine. Yeah, center. Yeah.
I would be dressed like a goalie.
Yeah.
All right, George, you have a rant against tractor trailers and how they always seem to be crashing.
It's not a rant. I've just noticed a lot of truck crashes lately.
6 people killed and 20 others injured after a charter bus that was carrying high school students in central Ohio, was rear-ended by a tractor trailer. This happened yesterday morning. It was a chain reaction crash. It ended up involving 5 vehicles. It took place just before 9 in the morning near Etna Township outside of Columbus. 3 of the victims were students. Two 18-year-old boys and a 15-year-old girl died. The others who died, one was a high school teacher, 56 years of age, and then 2 parents who were chaperoning were also killed, a 39-year-old woman and a 45-year-old woman.
Ugh.
Tractor trailer ran into the back of a charter bus.
I think he just fell asleep and just didn't brake?
I don't know. Just didn't see it. Took his eyes off the road for a second. Who knows? Messing with his phone, GPSing. We do pack a lot of distractions in a vehicle.
Man, no kidding.
And then when you got the music going loud and everything, people always make fun of, isn't that a thing where you make fun of guys who always have to turn down the radio when they're trying to figure out where they're going? Why would we make fun of people for doing that?
I don't know.
I have to do that.
I do that.
Yeah, when you don't know where you're going, you have to turn down the music.
When I got my last new car a couple of years ago, it was the first car I'd ever had with a touchscreen.
Mm-hmm.
The old dash is gone, and now all the new cars have a touchscreen.
That's a mistake in engineering.
Man, I couldn't believe what a distraction that was. How is that allowed?
I don't know, but you know, there's been a movement back to this. Everybody wanted to modernize and update their cars and make everything touch capacitive and all this stuff. And then even the car blogs that I always read, I read Bob Loblaw's car blog. And there was a whole movement back. Give us physical knobs and buttons.
Yes.
That's what works best. Things that you can work without having to look at it. And there's not the margin for error.
Yeah, we like knobs.
What is he doing?
He's doing a dirty joke.
I'm doing a radio show. What are y'all doing?
He's already mentioned the bush and the knobs.
I was agreeing with you. We like knobs.
You're trying to do a G.I. Jane joke, and I don't appreciate it. You keep, at least as far as my car, you keep my knob out of your mouth.
Okay.
Wow,
that's fine.
This was a very serious story there.
Very serious.
Female homebuyers now make up 19% of American homebuyers. That's almost double the rate of single men. Twice as many single women buy homes than single men.
Okay.
And this is a big contrast from 40 years ago when the portions were the same. 11% and 10% of 11% single women, 10% single men bought homes. But now women are buying 19% single women.
That's good.
I'm telling you, this is, it's ultimately going to be bad because I think that we're getting in a situation where women are outpacing men so much. And then you're going to start hearing the complaints about how men don't do anything. They're not graduating from college. They don't buy the home. The women are having to do everything.
Yeah, I guess I just had the thought of the dude just moving in his video game console and she's bought the home, so he's got it.
Yeah. That I'm telling you, that's what the world's going to eventually be. Everyone's going to be deadbeat males that the women do everything.
He's bringing his golf clubs and his video games. And hey, this is sweet.
You got this.
Like the oversimplified version of culture is women were upset because they didn't control everything. So men turned over control. And now women are saying, we don't want to control everything. We got to do everything now.
No, no, it's okay.
It's all right. I just want to play video games. That's all right. You can make more than me. Yeah, you can buy the house. Yeah, yeah, you can be the one that graduates college. Yeah, sure. You do all that. Get going. Get going. Anyway.
So if 19% of home buyers are single women, and you said that was about double, so roughly 10% are single men. So the rest of it is all married couples?
Well, also unmarried couples are buying too. That has changed also in that the, let me find this. Married couples has dropped to 59%. It used to be at 73%. And in the proportion of unmarried couples buying homes has risen slightly in the last four decades from 6% to 9%.
Okay.
6% in 1981, 9% in 2023. Typical single family buying, single female buying her first home, age 38, compared to 33 for a man. So the single man buying one is a little bit younger than the single woman buying one. And overall, home buyers are getting older. In the 80s, first time home buyers were 29 compared to 35 for this year. And this year, the typical home buyer is more likely to buy in cash. In 2023, what percentage of buyers do you think paid cash for their home to buy it outright instead of going with a mortgage interest rate?
With the high interest rates, people trying to avoid that mortgage, was it like 20%?
That's exactly right, 20%. Which sounds crazy, doesn't it? 20% can just buy a home outright.
Yes. Interesting.
That's up from 13% of people who did that in 2021. Birthdays today. Sam Waterston is 83, the actor from Law and Order, among other things,
who
George always said always acted like he had a head injury.
Nope.
Annie Fried Lyngstad of ABBA is 78. She's the brunette? Or was she? I think she's the brunette, not the blonde one.
That's your group. That's your go-to group.
The Swedish rock group ABBA.
Can I take that again? Casey wants to retract that one.
Dad on the phone.
Bob Gunton from The Shawshank Redemption is 78. Was that the warden? Mm. Bob Gunton? Mm. You think he was a good character?
Did you like his ending?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, he was. He did. He was such a good character.
The warden. He was great in that role.
Yes. Beverly D'Angelo is 72.
Happy birthday.
Tickets on. Kevin Eubanks from The Tonight Show with Jay Leno is 66. Judy Gold, the comedian, is 61. The tickets on Jack Ingram turns 53 today.
Oh, happy birthday, Jack.
Shailene Woodley is 32.
Aaron Rodgers' ex.
Emma Dumont from Oppenheimer is 29.
Still haven't seen that.
I haven't either.
Eh.
I know you didn't really like it.
Yeah, you hated it because you didn't write it. Is that what you said?
No.
You didn't star in it.
No, I watched it. I watched it, and it was like that. 7 hours long.
Yeah, it's long.
And even the person I went to the movie with, who is involved in movies themselves, said, good Lord, this thing's long. I snipped a few scenes out of that. Anyway, you're up to date. Bye.
All right, thanks. That's Muse. But joining us now on the Ticket Hotline to talk about a rough game last night in New Orleans where the Mavericks lost to the Pelicans, and Luka Doncic had 16 points, 8 turnovers, and 2 assists. Is the Mavericks superstar Luka? Good morning.
Oh, boy. What's going on?
Just don't expect
Giorgio.
To hear you. Don't expect to hear you sounding like this. You've really dropped your European accent,
man,
haven't you?
Man, I have embraced Texas, Bruda. Love Texas. A little bit trepidation because I think that you guys are probably going to want to talk about my bad performance last night.
Boy, that was rough.
But, man, can we talk about some other stuff? I mean, come on. I just cut a quarter horse out of a mess of baling wire that she ran into. Let's talk about that. Anything else, man?
Well, it was the latest game, and it was a tournament game, too.
Yeah, but it's basketball, and I hate all this basketball stuff. I just want to hang out on my ranch and turkey hunt, listen to Luke Combs music and stuff. He's good. Have you heard him, Giorgio?
Yeah, I know who Luke Combs is.
I know
you're
in country music and all that, so I'm pretty sure you probably heard of him. Man, I like his. I like that Fast Car song that he wrote.
Yeah.
Man, that guy can write a song. I mean, how do you come up with lyrics like that? Almost as if he lived another life.
Well, he didn't. Tracy Chapman wrote that more than 30 years ago.
I didn't know that. I'm sorry.
That's all right. That's okay. It's a good song.
Yeah, so 16 points. What are you going to do?
Yeah. Well, yeah, the 8 turnovers, too. That was pretty bad.
Well, let's ignore that. Hey, I got to confess. I know I don't look like it, but I'm a little out of shape. You know, I didn't come into this season 40 pounds overweight like I have before because I cut back on sweet taters and buttermilk pie, which I love. But I don't like working out, man.
Yeah.
If I'm working out, I'd rather be in a North 40 setting fence posts than being on the basketball court.
Well, I mean, that would keep you in shape.
2 minutes playing basketball, I'm sweating like a whore in church, just plum tuckered. But anyway, I still give it my best out on the court. I'm out on the court more than the other players. I think I'm busier than a cat covering crap on a marble floor. I'm working hard.
Well, don't worry about it. You've had a really good season up until last night.
I know, but it turned on me last night. I finally ran out of gas.
Out of gas?
I'm out of gas, man.
We got a long
way
to go.
I'll hang in there like a hare in grits. I'll hang around. Can't get rid of me. Like they say. Tenacity ain't just a town with 10 butts.
Tenacity. Yeah, you're right about that.
Tenacity.
Yeah.
But anyway, what else is going on, Giorgio?
Well, I don't know. You tell me. You're the superstar here.
Will you do me a favor?
Huh?
Will you tell whoever designed that floor in New Orleans that was not that great? I mean, they have a basketball floor there acting like it's all good and everything. And just do me a favor and tell whoever designed that floor that ain't that great.
Yeah. Well, we actually know the guy who designed it, and it was like 2 years in the making. So.
Oh. I'm terribly sorry. I didn't know that. I didn't know.
That's okay.
You're a good friend. Well, anyway, the color of that floor was crazy, man.
Yeah, it was.
I mean, I liked that they had the purple representing my horn frogs.
Your horn frogs.
But purple and neon green? I mean, hell, that looks like a social justice warrior's hair.
Oh,
that's some crazy colors. Although I shouldn't judge. I mean, whatever cranks your tractor, you know what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Whatever cranks your tractor.
There are dead spots on that floor. It's not just the color. I mean, there are some places that kick like a mule, and those spots is deader than grandma's papa.
You're full of them.
That's an uneven court, all right.
Yeah, it's uneven. I tell you what. And I told Coach Kidd, you know, I told him after last night's game that I wanted to quit the team. He made me have a meeting with Cuban. Cuban was not happy, brother.
Well, I guess not, if you said you're going to do that.
Madder than a cat getting baptized, Georgie.
Well, you can't quit 11 games into the season.
Well, I know. I mean, what am I going to do and everything? I got to pay off this big note I got on this ranch out here.
What are you going to do?
All right, Musers.
All right, Luca.
Hang in there, Luca. We'll see you. There he goes. There's Luca. Very Texan now.
Thank you, Craig. Before we get into some math, Tony says that that Oklahoma senator that we heard battling with the Teamsters dude that used to be a professional fighter.
Yeah.
And everything. So maybe he was a little bit more amped up and always wanted to solve things with his fist because he used to be a professional fighter.
Mm-hmm.
I never heard that.
Well, I knew he wrestled. I didn't know he fought. But yeah, maybe so.
Wrestling's not fighting?
Well, I guess it
looks real.
Not that kind of wrestling.
Oh.
Like, I think he was a college wrestler or something. I don't know. Anyway.
He was a Greek-Roman wrestler?
Sure.
Why is
Greco?
It? Yeah, but why can't you say Greek-Roman wrestling? Doesn't Greco stand for Greek?
I don't know. You want to take that one?
You're a sports expert, Craig.
It's just tradition. They always called it Greco.
It's called the way it is?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Fair enough. Chase says that we are being judgy about people drinking on a plane because we talked about how...
I agree.
When we're on planes, it just... And okay, here we get into the tricky subject of what is judgy and what is having an opinion on something.
Right.
Like, to me, it's you look over and it always looks a little bit... It makes me nervous when I see people really loading up on a plane.
Yeah, I don't think we've ever really taken somebody to task for having one drink after a long day.
Right, and I certainly don't stand up and slap it out of their hand and everything. And you shouldn't be doing that because Jesus. Nothing like that. I'm just saying that when you look over and somebody's got the three little bottles on their tray and they're kind of got shake hand as they put a Bloody Mary up to their mouth, it's just a little bit... I'm adding some stuff there, but he says, I'll have a couple double vodkas at the bar before getting on the plane. Then on the plane, I'll get about two or three vodkas, and not once have I ever had an incident.
Okay, speaking of math, that's seven shots of vodka.
Yeah, but okay, you noticing that was judgy.
I'm math man.
You seeing something in the world was a little bit
judgy. I just know
judgy.
How I would act if I went with two doubles... And then three on the plane.
Stop centering yourself in this conversation.
Right, forget it.
I have a play to run for everything you can say. I got
a
play.
Yes, you
run.
Do. Yep.
He says, except for that one time I had to choke someone out on a plane after he touched my stepmother's boob because they fed him six gins.
See?
All right. There's a lot in this sentence here, Chase. First of all.
Choked him out.
How are they... They feeding him six gins, but you are ordering seven drinks. Very confusing. Cell memory, the very interesting discussion we had during the ODEC this morning about how people with blood transfusions or organ transplants, they've had a transplanted organ put in them, that it changes their personality, and how scientists are studying this, that you can get blood transfusions and all of a sudden you start... getting some of the characteristics of the person that gave you the blood or the people that gave you the blood. They mix it all, right? It's not one person's blood you're getting. You're getting a bunch of different people's blood.
Yeah, most likely.
Shane says it's a very sci-fi idea, But what would really be a utopian or dystopian idea would be if they did discover that you could alter personalities via blood, and then we start rehabilitating criminals or offenders by forcing them to get transfusions from, like, Buddhist monks or somebody who's really not reactionary and someone who doesn't commit any crimes, some old grandma. So, yeah, you give them peace-loving, non-crime-committing grandma blood, and next thing you know, then they, all of a sudden they have dementia and they start crocheting in jail or knitting. Interesting idea. David has some insight on the trucking industry, as George has always romanticized truck drivers but says their wheels off and are always crashing their rigs.
Whoa, 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 whoa. I didn't say they're always wheels off.
I don't have time for you to respond to that. I'd have to read his email.
And they're not always crashing.
He says, Gordon, I'm sure you'll get some real truck drivers emailing, but I had a great uncle who drove a truck for 30 years and he loved it. At family reunions in the 80s, he would drive us kids around. And I remember that cab being the most disgusting thing ever. In hindsight, who the hell knows what we were rolling around in when we got in that bed in the sleeping compartment?
Mm. Yeah.
My uncle was also not the picture of health. He was probably 6'4", 350 pounds, and all that driving ended up killing him relatively young in his 50s when he threw a blood clot that killed him instantly.
Threw?
Yeah.
Can you be a little more delicate talking about your uncle?
Last week, I ran into a truck driver at a bar. We were both not drinking alcohol, so that started a conversation as to why we weren't. And he was about to go to Florida. We were in Fort Worth. He told me the respectable companies have governors on the trucks that lets them only go 67 to 69 miles per hour. Guys that own their own trucks don't care, and they can drive faster for longer hours. So if you want to go fast, you got to have your own truck. Be your own operator.
Okay. Just yesterday, I was driving home, and there was a trailer that looked to be like a dumpster that they picked up somewhere that must have been really heavy, because every time he would go around, not even a sharp turn, just a, if the road had just a little bit of a curve to it, I swear to you, the trailer almost tipped over a couple of times. And then he'd cut it back, and it would kind of wobble a little bit.
Really?
Yeah. I really thought that I was, after talking about it, that this thing was going to overturn right in front of me.
All right, I'll look up videos of wheels off truck drivers.
You know, your long claim that you could be a long-haul trucker, George?
Yeah.
I think the part that maybe you're discounting is what a beatdown it is if you're not on the highway going 60. That part is easy, but everything else, exiting, turning into a truck stop, parking it, all the little maneuvers you have to do with that giant thing, I think after 2 days you'd be beaten down by it.
Maybe, but I like backing trailers and all that stuff.
All right, let's drill down into
probably
why you
one
like
of the best trailer backers in the history of the state of Texas.
Is it that you like long highway trips?
Yeah, I like that.
No matter what the vehicle,
I just think that would be interesting to see America.
But why don't you say why don't you do it in an RV?
Yeah, could do that.
Isn't that a lot better?
Yeah, but you got a rig here. I've always thought the rig was really cool, didn't you?
The rig sounds like a beating. Much better is like your obsession with the Class A RV, like the Prevos and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Like, I get that, because you can sleep in it and see the world that way. Although that's a little bit
You've never looked at
around.
One of those big diesels idling and the light kit that they have and just the chrome and everything.
Yeah, sure. I look at it and think it's cool. When I was a kid, seeing Smokey and the Bandit and stuff.
Right.
Yeah. But I never thought that would be really great to drive around. It seemed like kind of a beating to drive it around. I wanted to drive the Corvette around. I mean, the Trans Am around. That sounded cool.
See, I wanted to be in the truck.
You want to be the Jerry Reed in this.
Right.
David continues as he talks with that truck driver. He asked the truck driver about the romance of the road, and the truck driver laughed in my face. He said if being tired all the time
and pooping in a trash bag and peeing in a milk jug is romantic. Well, I do that doing this job, so what's the difference?
Can you imagine if he never left the studio for that?
And you just went in the trash can over there? Just sit on the trash can. Of course, it collapses under you because of that little plastic
thing. That's
what
happens in here.
We also got on the subject of lot lizards.
And?
You know what a lot lizard is? It's probably a lot of listeners who don't.
Prostitute.
What?
Prostitute.
That was very robot, robot Craig.
Robot.
Prostitute.
Prostitute. In a truck stop parking lot.
Yes. He says there are multiple lot lizards at just about every truck stop.
And?
So it's very... It's all he commented on.
He didn't say whether...
That still goes on. They're still out there.
Yes. It's the oldest profession, George. It will always go on.
Okay.
I don't think they like being called lot lizards, though. I mean, we should update the terms here. They are companionship consultants.
Truck driver convenience valets.
Yes. Yes. They're convenience valets. Anyway, that's that. All right, math. We talked about the story that led Muse in the news today about the woman who decided she wanted to kill herself, so she turned into oncoming traffic, ended up killing the person in the other car. She lives and ends up killing one of the people in the other car. This happened in Irving on Monday, I believe it was. So when you talk with people about two people having a head-on collision, what is worse? Driving into a brick wall at 50 miles an hour or hitting someone head-on at 50 miles an hour and they're going 50 miles an hour?
You would think the other vehicle.
The second scenario should be worse.
Which is... a head-on collision head-on with another collision. Vehicle.
Both going 50.
And that is incorrect. So your intuition is incorrect on that. The answer is basically that it is the exact same. Hitting a wall at 50 miles an hour is the same as hitting someone going 50 miles an hour coming straight at you and you're going 50. If with equal mass and equal speed... two objects of equal mass and equal speed hitting each other is the same as hitting a brick wall.
Stationary.
Okay. Now there's a little bit of difference in that the rock material actually makes it to where that's a little bit worse than hitting a car going the same because the rock is a little bit more immovable.
Right.
But taking that out of the factor, it's when you're just concerning the speed and what our intuition says, we always think a head-on collision. You add the two vehicles' speed together.
Yeah.
But you don't just add them together. You actually average them is what it is. So if you're going 80 and I'm going 40 and we have a head-on collision, that's the same as hitting a rock wall going 60.
Okay. That makes sense. There's something
I think
that relates to we used to talk about. And our P1 Nick corrected us on this, I believe, that it was easier for a batter in baseball to hit a further home run off a 100-mile-an-hour fastball than a 90-mile-an-hour fastball. Intuition tells us that, but that's not correct.
Yeah, and that seems like it should be related somehow. Yeah.
Same thing, two very high-speed forces meeting together.
So does the bat somehow... jiu-jitsu the ball and uses its power against it and somehow makes it go farther?
Sweet tatas.
I think it
got
does
sweet
involve...
Sweet tatas as the first answer. We'll accept that provisionally.
It does involve jiu-jitsu. But I would like to add the caveat that I could be totally off base on this.
Okay.
And not remembering which baseball dynamic was kind of like this.
Well, in this scenario... does it really matter how fast the ball is going toward the bat?
Continue.
Christmas.
Like, would he hit it the same distance if it was a 77-mile-an-hour knuckleball?
I guess what it is because the ball has bounce to it. and the car doesn't quite have the same amount of bounce. Like, the ball is designed, if you throw it off of something, it will bounce. The harder you throw it, the farther it will bounce off an object, an immovable object, right?
You know, now that I think about it, maybe Nick corrected us on...
He corrected us on atmospheric conditions.
You can hit a baseball further
in cold weather
than you
than
can
warm weather.
And, yeah, something like that.
Or what? The opposite.
But I think there's also something to the Bo Jackson, Nolan Ryan thing.
There is something to the Christmas and the sweet tater thing, too.
I've never seen a home run look... I was there that night.
That's what your gut tells you, but it's actually wrong.
Well, no.
Hey, he said he didn't know, so that sounds like a pretty solid argument.
I don't know.
All right, we'll try to clear that up. All right, Gordo, thanks. That's the corner.
Get the Musers podcast at patreon.com/sportsgreek.
Well, look at this. A snake in the birdhouse.
Well, a corgi, actually.
What is going on?
Hey, hey, it's the snake.
You made it.
How are we doing?
Great, man. How are you?
I'm doing good.
Goody. It was great to hear you on the pigskin panel this morning.
It was a treat.
Yeah, and I want you to know that I, when I'm listening to that, I am in the shower, so I am nude and soapy. So thank you.
Why?
Thank you for the tones while I was in the shower.
Why do you have to tell me that?
Well, I thought we were friends. We're really good friends, and we're sharing, right?
We are sharing and caring. Okay. Yep. If for 1 year you had to go back 200 years, all
no,
right,
thank you.
Well, you have to.
1823.
I'm out.
It is three options here. You have to go back to the old ways of home, meaning no plumbing, AC, lights, or lights. So those three things. Or go back to transportation. So you're either walking or taking a horse. Or you go back to the food element of it, where you have to kill your own food or grow it all. Would you choose housing, food, or transportation? Or which one would you eliminate?
I could
ride
a horse.
You could go back to a house with AC, plumbing.
Yeah, I'd do that.
That's pretty important.
I think I would, too.
Because otherwise you're out on the prairie, and if it got really hot, you're just stuck there, and you have to open the window. Bugs and stuff would get all over you.
Man, but the whole killing your food.
You could fish. That's not... Freshwater fish back then. All the rivers had a ton of fish and whatnot.
We're still in Dallas. Where are you going to fish?
The Trinity probably back then was clean.
You want those?
You're thinking of
it
now.
Probably did have fish.
I'm thinking about originally 200 years ago before man polluted the earth. Plus, you could probably meet some friendly Native Americans and get in with them and they would help you.
Can you imagine how many people would try, once they figured out you had plumbing... Indoor plumbing where you just turned a knob and magic water came out of a faucet.
They would have no idea. They think you're a
your
witch.
Your waste would go away. Or in August, you can turn on a switch to pipe in cold air. How many people would be trying to get in your house?
Yeah, in the 200 years, 1823, a lot would.
You just go live on the prairie. Nobody would ever know you were there.
But I'd like to say I'm probably out. I don't want to go back.
You would just kill yourself.
Just don't want to go back.
Yeah, to that time, yeah.
Yeah, I'm out.
Yeah.
You guys tell
okay,
me.
No,
I can't blame you.
Thank you.
No guarantee of athletic stardom or any money guarantees with these scenarios. But would you rather be 6'3", 230 pounds, and semi-fast, meaning like a 4.8 40. 6'7" with a good jump shot. Just 7'2", and then take your pick on, you don't even know if you're good at anything, you're just 7'2".
Mm-hmm.
Or 5'10" with 4.4 speed and able to easily dunk. So you got great hops.
Oh, that is a great scenario.
I've been 6'3", 230.
What do you think you could turn the money into? Or what could turn that? Which one of those scenarios could turn into money?
I think the
5'10".
I think the 7 foot, just being 7 foot is out.
Yeah, because you die very early. There are no super tall old people.
And then, you know, if you're not guaranteed to be an athletic 7'2", or 7 foot, then that would kind of suck if you're just 7 foot with nothing to show for it.
Get your bartending license.
And, you know, true. If you worked hard enough, maybe. But 5'10", with blazing speed and incredible hops, I think that may be the one.
Hands down, you could be a stud cornerback in the NFL. You could be pretty much anything.
Probably even still play basketball.
Yeah, you could be Charlie Ward. Go two-way in college and then decide, oh, I'm going to be a point guard in the NBA.
Yeah, I'll take the
5'10". What about 6'7"? What about 6'7" with a good jump shot?
A good jump shot is not going to get you anywhere.
But you're slow. You could be stick thin.
Yeah.
I know a couple of 6'7" dudes, and they played basketball in high school. What do they do now? Not that.
And it's, dude, we've talked about this before. It is really difficult to go through life like 6'6" and above if you're not loaded, able to customize cars.
I know.
And
yeah.
First class flying. And
so you're on a, you know, even if you're going to my cousin is 6'8" and he played basketball overseas. But when we go to a game, and he has his knees up to his chest because those are the only seats and on a flight or whatever, man. Even when he's in my car, he puts the seat all the way back and he's still kissing his knees. So yeah, I think that would suck.
It's hard. It's very, very difficult. Man, the 7'2 thing, though, there's a good chance that is the ultimate moneymaker, just being 7'2". Like, you would play college basketball.
Yeah, but what if you suck?
You would think.
I know. I wouldn't take that. It's just too tall. Okay, if you were trapped in a Home Depot or Lowe's overnight during a zombie apocalypse, and the zombies get in, you can use three things inside the place to fend off zombies. What three are you picking? And his ranch pizza says you can't just hide in a fridge.
A 9-inch nail gun would be number one for me.
Okay, that's what I thought of when I read this. They do sell nail guns in there, like hardcore nail guns.
Yeah, and you need like construction size, like, because there's different inches of nails, and the bigger the nail, the
gun. That's the first thing I thought about.
Yeah, the gun would be powerful enough where you could brain shot them. And then
I would say something like a saw, a circular saw or something, but you have to get really close to them.
Yeah, if you
cordless, I'm assuming, or what are we charging this thing with?
Yeah, you could do well. You could just plug in anywhere, and plus, if you had a nail
the
gun,
electricity still up in the apocalypse.
Yeah, you could go down the plywood aisle and build yourself a structure that they couldn't get into, and just nail gun them out of a little window that you cut. So yeah,
okay, that's you don't have time to build a house.
Do you have the pencil behind your ear and then you're writing down measurements?
Saying build a house, but
as
if they have a
just
nail gun,
slowly walking towards
they
you.
Have little pre-cut plywood on aisles. You just nail it together.
Uh-oh.
Seriously, Matt's over there trying to build.
Belt. Yeah.
Yeah, trying to build a 2-3 with a with a back porch.
He kind of holds up the 2x4, like, no, that's not cut enough.
I would just but if you can't do that, then I would say a nail gun would be number one, an axe, and then you probably need something for close quarter combat, so a hatchet or a screwdriver.
Maybe you need a nice soda because you'll get tired fighting the.
I'm assuming you have access to everything. You can go into the
he
little
said
mini fridges.
You can pick three items.
I would take a Starbucks gift card.
I'd take one of the toilets there.
Yeah, well, yeah. What if that? Like a zombie's coming and you're like, I'm getting ready to S my pants.
it's one of your items. You just sit there like,
you just
hang
sit
on.
Down.
Hang on. Do they? And then the zombies walk over and they smell it and go, That's my zombie.
Go sound. Try to get in Matt's house.
You could get
that he's still building.
You could get like sodium hydroxide.
What is that?
It's like lye. It dissolves bodies and stuff. You know?
Yes, science. What do you sodium hydroxide? How do you know what that is?
It doesn't matter.
I just a psychopath.
You know, lie. You just L-Y-E that you can dissolve.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
So maybe you could, if you had enough of that, you could rig it up to the ceiling and get up there and dump it on the whole store and just melt them all.
You dump it on the whole store, or do you just feed into the sprinkler system?
Yeah, something
and then
like that.
When you light a match right when they're walking to you.
Again, we don't know what we're doing when it comes to that. Just take an axe. take a nail gun, take a
circular
shovel,
saw,
just a thought.
Something. Right.
Just a thought.
Right. Let's not try to home alone our way through a zombie apocalypse.
Although that would be funny if you did.
Marble booby trap.
Yeah, because they wouldn't climb up there.
You have the bucket on the string.
Right.
You let it go and it just knocks one of the heads off.
Slowest battle of all time.
That'd be a great movie. Home Alone and the Apocalypse. The zombie
right,
apocalypse.
Home Alone and Home Depot.
There
yeah.
you go.
Within the four big sports, who's your all-time favorite athlete who never played for a college or pro team that you rooted for? And this guy says, this is from Tim, Donnie, you can't use Randall Cunningham because he ended up being a Cowboy.
Oh, he sure did.
That never played for a college or pro team that you rooted for.
Yeah, so just some random team that, you know, you have no allegiance to whatsoever. That you rooted for hard or currently root for
in the Big Four. Boy, that's a good one,
man. Mine might be Steph.
Could you include?
I have zero allegiance to him, and I just love watching him play.
Could it be Jordan?
Yes,
it could be Jordan.
Jordan would be mine.
The ceiling is the roof.
But I loved the Bulls as a kid, but it was because of Jordan. Like, I wanted to be Jordan.
Man, I really liked Kobe. I liked watching him. I don't know. I have to think about that one. Let me get back to you.
Could be a golfer.
Yeah, I was thinking Tiger.
You said Big Four.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
Because then, don't you attach yourself to that, and you're always rooting for Tiger, and he's like the team that you kind of go for.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, as a kid, I really enjoyed watching Joe Montana.
Dan Marino.
No, not Dan Marino.
Man,
I don't know how hard I rooted for him. Yeah, let me get back to you on that one.
Okay, call me. You know where I am.
I will.
This is from EA. You're the king of Thanksgiving. What side is thrown out forever?
Gravy.
And he says, why is it cranberry sauce?
Cranberry sauce is awesome.
I don't mind cranberry sauce that's well done.
Like, do you get any that's medium rare?
Not that well. I mean, that's done, that's prepared correctly, not cooked well done. I would say, man, I am not that big of a fan of stuffing and or dressing.
I am. If it's done properly, it's delicious.
It's got to be done right.
Oh, of course. Yeah, you have to have a little moisture in your dressing. Yeah.
The problem is, once my grandma died, I never had any... I guess dressing is what she called it, that I thought was any good. And she died in like 1990, so it's been 30 years.
Stuffing is when they shove it in the turkey, right? And you eat it out, and it comes out of the turkey, and then dressing is just, we never put it inside the turkey.
Yes, correct? That's exactly right.
We never call it
always
stuffing.
It's
just always dressing. It's always been dressing for me.
Yeah, did you guys ever get a spoon, stick it inside the cooked turkey's bottom and pull out the stuffing?
No.
Like, I've seen it done on TV, but I've never actually seen it done for real.
I don't think but I've eaten it after somebody did that.
You know what could be eliminated? If it's not gravy, because gravy may not be an official side and I just hate gravy so much, is the little lime Jello looking salad with the pecans and all
and
that stuff on it. Oh,
stuff?
That is
what?
Disgusting.
Terrible. What is that?
I don't like that either.
It always shows up at Thanksgiving. That's the only time I ever see it, and I always skip over it.
Like real
and
cranberry
it's a random,
sauce is good.
Oof. Like a random relative
but,
that'll
okay,
bring it too.
I'll give you another side that's pretty popular that I could 100% do it out. Corn.
Just corn?
Just basic corn?
Yep.
What about corn on the cob?
Cream of corn.
Creamed corn.
Nope. I can do way without it.
Mexican street corn.
I'm good.
Out.
Roasted corn.
Nope.
On the cob.
Nope.
In a soup.
Mm-mm.
Popcorn tortilla chips is a good one, too.
I gotta tell you, and this is probably blasphemy for Thanksgiving, but if I never ate pumpkin pie again, I'd be good to go.
Oh, that's not blasphemy. That's the truth, because I don't eat it.
It's all right.
What about sweet potato pie?
Oh, that's delicious.
Grody.
There you go.
Right?
I
agree.
Delicious. That's the only pie I will eat.
I'll take pumpkin over sweet potato.
What about pecan pie? What about
I'm out.
Gelatinous stuff that's in that pecan pie? There's weird stuff
in
pecan pie.
I know. To make it all...
Yeah,
stick together.
A good pecan pie, I can eat it. I prefer cherry pie.
I'd rather just favorite. Have a handful of pecans.
The best dessert out too. There is just good old-fashioned plain pound cake. That's the best. Okay.
That's never made on Thanksgiving, is it?
Oh, yes the hell it is. At my house, it is.
It is?
I don't think I like yams, but I like sweet potatoes, and they're not the same thing.
You know what? I forgot about the concept. I like sweet potato pie, but I hate sweet potatoes.
Dude, I just had a sweet potato last night.
So did I. Yeah.
They're so healthy
like
for you.
Skin? With the skin?
You can eat them.
If you want to, but you just open it up and dress it how you want to and just eat the sweet potato. And it's delicious.
No, I'm out. That's just
little cinnamon. The butter.
Ugh. Dude, the ones fantastic. The purple ones from Japan are phenomenal. You ever see those around?
Okay.
Japanese sweet potatoes?
Yeah, they're called like Murasaki or something like that, but yeah, they're really good.
How do you know what that is, and yet you ate purple. Edamame the whole husk?
Just chewed the whole thing like a banana. Just put the banana in your mouth.
I forgot about that. I thought it was something else.
No, you didn't.
Yes,
you
did.
Just didn't know. All right, thank
that
you, Snake.
Awesome.
Thank you, P1s. Good stuff, Corby.
Once again, The Ticket presents... Why Today Doesn't Suck.
Let's go down and talk to John Rattigan, who has Colby Lewis with him.
Yeah, we got Colby here. Try to put into words how you're feeling right now, Colby.
Ah, it sucks.
And now, here are your hosts, John Bass and David Mino.
This is going to be a f***ing disaster.
The Sweet Spot, special thanks to our very good friends, Matt Duchesne, Travis L. Brown, and Lando, the star of Time Crunch.
Yep.
And at 3 o'clock... Ham.
Thank you, Mino. Eatsy's Market and Bakery and Sante Center for Healing brings you Minto.
Thank you so much, Hammy. I don't know if Lando shared the text message he got from EA, but EA, who was listening...
It was a picture, right? Of
him holding it? No.
No, what's underneath that?
He just texted Landrum, I would be honored to be your love interest in a movie.
And then
I
the
told him I'd
and
take
then
it
the
up
picture.
On it. I bet EA's in a lot of exploration down
EA,
there.
If you're listening, no pictures, please. No pictures.
You could probably make him see heaven in 30 seconds.
I bet he's a good kisser, from what I've heard.
Look at him.
As long as you can handle him breathing really heavily into your face.
Oh, yeah.
All right, well, we say hello to the hard line. Corby, Bob, Dave, the Corba. Original ones Dave. To identify EA's Snorneck.
Hello.
Oh, they're over there.
Hey, bros.
That way.
We are right next door to you right now.
I could throw a football to Mino.
Right over now. Them mountains.
Could you shoot a ping pong ball?
Hey, down.
So what are we doing? Just hanging out or?
Oh, yeah. Well, sorry, we probably should have told you. It's the SMU Athletic Forum. Duh.
Oh, it's the dub. Huh?
Tight. Who's there today?
Pete DeBoer!
Heck yeah.
Has Dak
win last night.
Back since we hung out with him, Mino?
We said if they didn't win last night, then we weren't coming.
So yeah. They played for you guys?
Dak once thought that Justin was drinking whiskey at 1:30 in the afternoon when we talked to him.
He's hey,
our,
George,
he's our buddy,
me a
too.
Drink.
Dak Prescott.
Sure, what do you want?
Whiskey.
And then he's like, yeah, I could see why that guy needs a drink. He's cool with it.
And he's like, I'm going to put up over 400 yards against the Giants in a game this season. No big deal.
I'm going to suck really hard against the Niners just for you.
Easy.
At the game. We're not talking about EA and Kevin anymore.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Well, today is Wednesday, November the 15th, the 319th day of 2023.
Oh, God
bless you.
Someone got COVID.
Might, no.
Maybe.
I don't.
Okay. At least you're over there with them.
Not everything's COVID. You know, I need to put that...
Sometimes it's AIDS.
I need to put that statement out that I have non-COVID-related illness.
Who's got AIDS?
I like that the NBA does that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You need to wear a mask around Pete DeBoer.
We don't need him sick.
Yeah,
right
yeah
now.
Don't give him what you call the Hong Kong flu.
Yeah, we don't want Matt Duchesne sick, so wear a mask but around DeBoer. Yeah.
Pete and I have always greeted each other with an open mouth kiss, so this is going to be weird.
If y'all remember
that'd
to call
be awkward.
Pete DeBoer.
Pete DeBoer.
From what I remember, some weeks you just slipped your mind to call the coach.
Happened once. Wasn't my fault.
We had to call the head coach of the Dallas Stars today. Forgot. 319 day of 2023, 46 left in the year. On this date, in 1879, Princeton beat Harvard 1-0 in a college football game held in New Jersey. Remember, they had weird rules back then. Mm-hmm. But this was like the Mike McDaniels of their era. Because the Tigers unveiled the concept of using blockers to help advance the ball.
Whoa.
Do you think it will work?
And a seal here.
Just think if they'd have been in a slinging a round off.
I mean, we can try it, but it's never going to work, coach.
It just sucks. Like, every time I run the ball, immediately one of their guys tackles me.
Right. What options do we have?
Can somebody get in the way?
No. So what did the linemen do? They just stood up and looked around
what
like,
were they doing before
what's
that?
Happening?
Yeah.
Was it just 11 receivers against 11 DBs at all times?
It does beg the question, what do you do here exactly?
The first try at a block, the guy backed into him, and it didn't really work.
Sounds like Terrence Steele would have done well back then.
No way!
In 1984, Baby Faye, a month old infant who received a baboon heart,
Baby KK?
Died at Loma Linda University Medical Center.
Little Baby Faye Faye.
That's so Baby KK.
Yeah, what if they started calling him Baby Faye Faye?
Classic Baby KK.
Would you give your infant a baboon heart if there was a 50% chance they turned into a baboon?
It's a monkey!
No.
It'd be pretty
I'm
fun.
Go ahead and
your
say no.
Is turning into a baboon.
But you would let them die? That's their only chance at life.
To raise a baboon.
I think that would
then
be kind of kick
face
ass.
Off.
Well, yeah that's part of the deal.
You get to watch a baboon.
I would do it only if there was a 100% chance he turned into a baboon.
And they grow a red ass.
Yeah, that'd be pretty sweet. All the time.
Red.
Man.
Red ass is a good word.
Drop the baby in the dumpster and go adopt a baboon.
Bunky.
Because that's your baboon, Dave.
I just would like to live
baby baboon.
The movie Ed.
Baboon.
Now you have a baboon.
Minor league major.
Yeah, he's like the eighth best prospect in the Reds organization.
The Rangers have to protect it from the Rule 5 draft.
Yeah. Sweet.
Add it to the 40 man.
Rangers. Baby died here, by the way.
Mm.
In the year 1986, the Beastie Boys released their debut album, License to Ill, which was the first number one rap album on the Billboard charts.
McLaren loved it.
Yeah, it's great.
Did not like that one.
You're like, what? White guys are going to rap?
Weird.
Send it to number one.
And then Vanilla Ice was like, yeah, I'll go ahead and ruin it for everybody.
In took a few to get it down, but they got it.
2001, Microsoft released Xbox, a video game console system. Pretty sweet. Pretty expensive back then, hard to get.
It's a little bit after PlayStation, right?
Because
PlayStation
I think so,
was probably late 90s.
After PS2?
Yeah, I think PS2 was about 01. 2000, maybe.
Corby, your take.
1999 to the 2000.
Yeah,
PS3 was 2006, November 11th.
All right.
Did that have the game Tank on it?
Tank.
Yeah, PS2 had to be around 2000, 2001, because all the Mavericks had it in their lockers at the AAC.
That's true.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Next to the robe.
You're not going to believe how many free agents show up here because they can get a video game.
We can play Crazy Taxi.
That's how they got Rafe LaFrance.
In each locker,
sweet.
We have a machine
that was Dreamcast. Point
that can play VHS or Beta.
Yeah.
But the Mavs, it's how you get Anton Jameson.
Midnight Club, maybe.
Crash Bandicoot.
Who did the Hardline have on that was visiting? Supersonic Rashard Lewis?
Yeah.
Future Maverick.
You wanted to play Power Stones.
I believe he was brought by as they were showing him through town.
Yeah.
As everybody taking part in the interview was extremely confused.
Where's Tank at, man? Let's see. In 2011, Duke University basketball coach Mike Krzyzewski recorded his 903rd career win, surpassing Bob Knight to become the winningest coach in NCAA Division I men's history.
Spell Krzyzewski. Not Justin.
The rest looking at of it. The story.
I feel pretty confident right now.
K-R-Z-Y.
No, you're already wrong.
No, he's right
so far.
I am. You're right so far.
E-W-S-K-I.
You were missing one know. Z.
Yeah.
Mm.
It's
dang
that
it.
Sneaky Z.
It's K-R-Z-Y-Z.
Two Z's between the Y.
E-W-S-K-I. Pretty close.
Crushed it.
In 2019.
Z-Y-Z, that was a Rush record?
It's Y-Y-Z, and it's a song.
It's a song.
The first time Ham's talked all day, and that's to correct you on that.
Go Dave.
He's like Rush Police. Something about that chair. All the Rush stands are in that chair.
I need to thank Ham as he presented me with a baby shower gift today.
Aw. Was it a can of ravioli?
Little baby boy's first Batman costume.
Okay.
Right. Oh, nice.
Also on the bingo card.
Was it his?
No, it's brand new. It has never been worn.
Okay. It's got a little...
See? Oh, look at that. It's got a little... socks and a little beanie with the bat ears. And then...
Got a little stun
a
gun.
A onesie with abs. And the tool belt.
That's great.
With bat nuggets.
Bob Greasy's going to love it. And in 2019, The Joker, starring Joaquin Phoenix, becomes the first R-rated film to earn $1 billion at the box office.
Joaquin Phoenix?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Joaquin Phoenix.
L4G, according to a mistake that I made a long time ago. I called him Joaquin Phoenix on accident.
And really, they still call you out on it.
One of many things that I just can't outrun.
Has Joaquin Phoenix ever done Shakespeare?
Shakespeare!
I don't know.
Foo Fighters.
Joaquin Phoenix.
At the Oscars, he wore a suit.
For
a long time,
Fighters.
P1, some of them. Justin, a.k.a. the Cocaine Caveman. It's his birthday. His leaders are Fake Steven Jones and Monty's Nub. I'd love to hear a Sturmgasm followed by a load of Corbys being shot in rapid succession.
Please. Load. Said load.
Get some! Get some! That's probably pretty good. Also, hey Monty, since Alex got my last two birthdays read, guess it's time for me to pay it back. Today is Engineer Alex's 29th birthday.
Oh,
no.
Good dude.
He is not at the station today,
Commander.
But he's celebrating.
Commander in ear.
Like all good, fully-blooded Hispanics do, with downing three shots of tequila and running around Saginaw, shaking his maracas and poo-bearing it in his poncho.
Yikes.
His leaders
That's
are
a good
Bob,
dude, that Alex.
Mexican Dracula and the rest of his Hispanic brethren at the ticket.
See?
I say, orale, bro. He would like to ask Lee Corso, is he still a jerk and are we still having fun here? Thanks, guys.
I wonder if Alex considers me his top Mexican ally at the station.
He does not.
He clearly doesn't.
You did play El
Feliz
Chapo
cumpleaños. Alex.
He's done nothing but put our culture down for 25 years, Corby.
Yeah, I want a spinoff of Corby as Al Chapo.
Yeah.
Al Chapo?
Al Chapo.
Al Chapo.
Hey, guys.
I'm
hey,
the
Al
Chapo.
All right, birthday is today.
You have me confused.
Waterston is 83.
Now, Al Chapo always says, hoo-ah.
Hoo-ah.
We're having fun here. Little ass. Singer Annie Fried Lyngstad of ABBA, 78. Corby. Are you standing up or sitting down?
I'm currently sitting.
Do the other one.
No, stand up.
All right, now I'm standing.
For those of us who can't.
No, he's not.
God love you.
Now sit back down.
Turning 72 today, Beverly D'Angelo.
Oh.
And which movie did she show her headlights in?
Vacation 1.
Yes. Maybe. Many people
sure
think it was bubble voice. Many people think it was European, but it was the original.
Well, that is some bubble voice.
I didn't even have anything to drink. I don't understand.
It was so bubble voice. Oh, it's great.
Next time you get it, could you say Scott Baio after school special?
Yeah, I just got to lean into it.
Those are top tier.
Yeah. Are y'all looking at Beverly D'Angelo's up top?
No, we're looking at the Rangers just put out a new wallpaper.
There's a new farm ranking.
I think, though, that I was, wallpaper I was very influenced by those.
Did you go EA on yourself?
They meant a lot to me. Is it?
Which one?
12-year-old.
You held them near and dear?
Beverly D'Angelo.
Meanwhile, I'm over here trying to figure out the hardline run sheet for today.
who's the Asian kid with Bob?
What is going on?
Scott.
Is it turning into NBA Brazil?
Oh, my God.
This is the weirdest one yet.
It needs to be a little more sexual.
Who's the other guy?
That guy is.
Is that DJ somehow, or?
It's like Gene Simmons.
Like a Buddhist monk.
Let's see.
A soccer ball.
Ray McKinnon from Deadwood, 66. Kevin Eubanks, the Leno guitarist, is also 66.
Weed.
E-40.
This is insane.
Is 56.
Yep.
Nope.
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 Jack Ingram, 53.
Our boy Jack. Happy birthday, bud.
Am I having a birthday? Yep.
Hey, Sean. Johnny Miller, 51. He is an actor that, to me, looks just like BTO. Look up Johnny Lee Miller.
Bob,
Johnny,
you look kind of Asian in this.
Chad Kroger, or Kruger.
That's not actually
DJ,
me, Corby.
It's 49.
Nickelback.
From Creed.
Of Creed.
We all know it's Kruger.
Christian Andrew, 47. Guitarist for Gojira.
Gojira. Rando.
That's his favorite band of all time.
One of.
Yep.
Winston Duke, the actor, 37. B.O.B., the rapper, 35. Bob, Shailene Woodley, 32. An Aaron squeeze? She made him.
Yeah. Wasn't she like
the. How was her first name pronounced?
Shailene.
Wasn't she the.
Like heard,
no,
like
she. Okay, she ways. Was. She Shailene, was from Big Little Lies.
Shailene sounds real East Texas.
She wasn't.
Yeah,
very 90s.
Was she also the practicing witch? Or which one was the witch?
In what
she
show?
She was the witch, right?
No, like Aaron Rodgers.
Oh, yeah.
Dating a witch.
Yeah.
The Earth Woman?
No, and you leave her alone.
That's Bob.
Like standing up for your squeeze.
Yeah, well, she's not a witch.
The witch was the one after Shailene.
Let me plow
she may
that.
Be underage, but.
She made a wood?
She Dallas
floats.
Native, Trevor Story, 31.
He's the same as the
future
Dallas
Ranger.
Patriot. Dylan Bundy, also 31.
They have metal.
Carl Anthony Towns, 28.
It was a Trevor Story bet.
Boy, I would have lost a lot of money betting on this stock. Malik Jefferson, 27.
Dang, same. Cowboy, though, right?
For a bit, yeah, right?
Yes.
No, I think, like, now.
Practice squad?
I think he is taxi squad-ish. Call him up in case they need a linebacker on game day.
I heard they just lost a linebacker for a bit.
He's number 46.
That's what I'm hearing.
Also,
46 in your heart.
Turning 22 today, the future of the Rangers outfield, Wyatt Langford.
Oh, baby.
Hell,
yes.
They get him, they might win a World Series.
Three.
More than say now, Dad.
Until
Randy
he's traded
Savage,
for Mike Trout.
Old dirty Legend. Bastard.
Legend. I thought that was yesterday.
That was his
death day.
Oh, wow. Today is his birthday. Ed Asner. Two, we also have Dallas Day Still Dead two, in 2017. Two. Lil Peep.
Oh, my goodness.
Lil Peep died.
Shut it down.
Come, let's watch the rain as it's falling down. R.I.P. Peep.
Broadcasting live from the TXU Fire Energy Mothership.
D-E-A-T-H. What does that spell? Death, 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 death.
Well, it is that time, isn't it? Time for us to discuss the life and times of somebody who's passed away and decide their worthiness for the trifecta, for the three-bedroom apartment in the sky. And today, We will test the limits, test the rules of this game a little bit, if I were to guess. Because I've been waiting to talk about the passing of the general himself, the three-year weekly guest on Bad Radio, I want to say.
Was it really?
I think so.
God, why'd y'all stop it?
I think you got it stopped.
Oh, my bad.
Robert Montgomery Knight passed away at age 83 on the 1st of November. He won 902 Division I men's basketball games, a record at the time of his retirement, sixth all-time at the time of his death. He won three national championships, including the perfect season of 1976, the Isaiah Thomas year of 1981, and the Keith Smart shot of 1987. Went to five Final Fours in Indiana. Was a champion as a player, by the way, for Ohio State.
I bet they ran, man.
With, was he college mates with Jack Nicklaus? I'm trying to remember.
I think that's right. How old was Bobby when he died?
83.
Yeah, Jack's about 84, 5, something like that.
Henry Iba Award winner in 75 and 89. Naismith College Coach of the Year, 87. AP Coach of the Year, 75, 76, 89. Big Ten Coach of the Year, 75, 76, 80, 81, 89. And Basketball Hall of Fame in 91. College Basketball Hall of Fame, 2006. Pan American Games gold medal 1979, Olympic Game gold medal 1984, all as head coach.
And discovered Michael Jordan.
Head coach at Army, head coach at Indiana, head coach at Texas Tech. What else?
Remember when he had Jordan on that Olympic team and he had all those studs on there and he was like, I've never seen a human being play basketball like this in my life.
Yeah, and I heard John Feinstein on with the Musers, and I know that this gets a lot of... the rolling of the ice hand sign and also the rolling of the eyes, but when you call him a complicated man, I think that's usually code for a-hole, but also code for complicated old-school coach.
He literally is a guy that had his career started in 1995, he would be out of whatever league he was in by 2001.
Probably, or not probably, certainly. Now, let me go the other direction and say, had he coached his entire career and retired in the 80s, we might call him Vince Lombardi.
Yeah.
We might call him, I don't know what other sort of hard-nosed coaches of the old days. I don't know where some of these guys sit, but there was a time, especially before sports media got so cynical, that these guys were allowed to do whatever they want, whenever they want, and if they were winning, that made them right.
Yeah.
And they were legendary, and there were statues, and there were arenas named after them, and nobody said a bad word ever, 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 because that's how a young man should be disciplined so that he can reach his full potential.
I mean, people thought it was hilarious when he threw the chair. People thought it was awesome.
Yeah, it's complicated, isn't it? Because we live this in real time. I remember as a high school kid thinking that, A, there's nothing more fun than heckling Bob Knight when they came to play Wisconsin, and B, there's nothing more fun than getting Bob Knight's autograph after the game, because I can't believe I'm standing next to Bob Knight and he's signing my program.
Like, as a,
and he did both.
And you're right. You're right on that. But as like a 14, 15, 16-year-old kid that's kind of coming into his own and realizing maybe what the world is about, he went from, my God, this is Vince Lombardi, to, again, as a junior in high school, I'm like, I cannot stand this guy. Like, he does things the wrong way. He's a terrible human being. You could tell he was manipulating the media, that he was condescending to everyone that disagreed with him. He's basically basketball Trump.
Counterpoint?
Go on.
If you were playing basketball at the time, there's a chance you had a coach who worshipped him and sent you to the Randy Whitman basketball school, which Randy Whitman played for him, of course, before he went on to be an NBA coach, I want to say. And really everything he taught, from the way they played man-to-man to the way they played their motion offense to the way they won to the way they were disciplined for each other and would run, you know, laps because so-and-so. It's military. I mean, it's absolutely the boot camp society we all grew up at. And at the boot camp, the drill sergeant is absolutely going to MF scream at you all the time.
I have no worries with MFs.
Well, I'm saying may get physical. May even grab a young soldier.
A little choke every once in a while.
I'm not minimizing it. I'm saying that was cool in society until
it wasn't.
Until it wasn't. And when it wasn't, those guys caught generationally in between were chastised heavily by popular thought. But, man, for a long time, we kind of built them into legends before we tore them down, right?
Yeah, but he was the ultimate horse's ass.
Bully.
Yeah, he was. And again, that's why I say he's basketball Trump. People love Trump, obviously. I mean, the people that work with him, people that swear by the way he does business.
His methods work.
Exactly. Yeah, there's no doubt about it.
They're focused on the results and the cult of personality.
But the results justify any behavior.
You know what's funny? At about the same age, Donald Trump became a part of our lives, too, and I'm like, I don't like that guy either. Like, they both kind of seem like the same dude, you know, just above the law, above everything. But they had this veneer about them that I knew it wasn't right human beings.
And they generally resonate to people from that time.
For sure. 100%.
So I'm not saying you're crazy there. I am saying
I'm saying that
you and I feel differently about him only because I was raised to kind of think that he was right on most of these basketball points.
Well, I was too.
What was the tipping point in public perception? Was it the Texas Tech receptionist?
I don't even remember the salad thing or what.
Yeah, didn't
what
he throw something?
Was the salad thing at Tech or Indiana?
That was at Tech.
Well, no, the public. That was the school president,
right?
Yeah, the things changed when Indiana was like, get away, like seriously, get out of here.
Yeah, and let's not bend over backwards calling them some stand up. They put up with it for.
Of course they did because they were winning.
15 years after his last title,
100%. He became. It got worse and worse and worse, and then by the time that people started filming things, you know, and recording things, he got caught in the middle of that and got in the big dust-up with the university, and, you know, he just seemed like at that point, and he was only in his 50s at that time. He was not that old, but we thought of him as like this ancient dude.
I'm telling you.
He got run for just being a miserable sack of human garbage.
We were at the 94 NCAA tournament. It was at the Cap Center in Washington, D.C., and Liberty was there. And we played North Carolina in the 1-16 game. And I want to say that night, Indiana might have played Temple like in the 8-9 game or something like that. I don't remember. All I remember is I was sitting courtside doing Liberty Radio, and I wasn't going to move because Indiana was playing in the next game.
Yeah, and they weren't even good.
And let me tell you something. When Bob Knight walked out of the tunnel, the entire arena stopped. Like there's layup lines, and everybody just couldn't believe they were in the presence of Bob Knight. And this is game before Dean Smith was coaching.
He was 52 that year.
Is
that not weird?
I've never seen Darth Vader more up close. And then, of course, the Bob and Dan trip to Lubbock where we were sitting in the locker room and waiting for him to get done with whatever he was doing between practice and meeting us because he had to meet us to do the radio show with us. And we're sitting there, and Tim Knight and Pat Knight get in a screaming match that went a good 2 to 3 minutes. And they were in the presence of us, and they were ripping each other mercilessly with F-bombs and insults that would absolutely shock anybody. And we're just sitting there kind of trying to look at our phones and act like this is all totally normal. And it was just, it was such a out-of-body experience. And then, of course, all of the weird moments on the air. And then, of course, your weird moment on the air, which I think probably ended things. But we were probably done anyway, but
when did he choke out Neil Reed? What year was that?
Oh, probably 2000, if I were to guess, 99.
Wait, when was he at Tech?
probably 03 to 09, something like that. Let me check.
I'm getting my timeline completely confused here.
His end at Indiana was 2000. Okay.
So Neil Reed would have been 98, 99.
Man, I thought Neil Reed was the end, wasn't it?
Well, I mean, that's what I'm saying. Didn't he get a little bit more time? I don't know.
And then Tech 01 to 08.
God.
And they were pretty good. They won 20-some games every year until they stopped winning 20-some games. And then I think in 08 he gave the job to Pat or something, right? Because he was constantly warring with...
It's Trumpy. It's all very Trumpy.
Yeah, and he was at war, and Mike Leach seemed to be at war with Tech at the same time. And I believe at the time I kind of thought that Bob Knight might have wore off on Mike Leach a little bit, and Mike's like, "Oh, we don't have to listen to these guys."
Yeah,
it was a weird sports time.
I thought it was a receptionist. It was when he threw his salad at the Tech
school
chancellor.
President. Oh, okay, yeah.
At the chancellor. Again, I understand the basketball greatness, and I understand the people that swore by him and said that he molded lives
and still
did
do.
All the, and did all. Of course, they do. Did all these great things. I also understand that there are two sides to it. And he was a really terrible human that none of us would have got along with in real life.
Do we have the audio that ended the Bob and Dan show with
So, and this
Bobby
is the
Knight?
Other thing. He had just gone hunting and blew someone's head off, basically.
That's not what happened, Corby.
He sprayed him with buckshot, right?
He did. And then there
Kinda
was like
Dick Cheney.
But then didn't want to like own up to it, you know, and was like very – wouldn't – was standoffish about it and claimed that it wasn't his fault and all the, you know, typical Bob Knight type thing. And so he came on the air with us like, I don't know, a month after that. And it was White Elephant Day. And Dan and I were hosting whatever version of White Elephant. I think it may have been White Elephant.
Yeah,
it was.
It absolutely was.
Okay. I know we were back at our old studio off Maple. And at the very end, and I cannot believe video of this exists. Who was filming this?
No idea.
I think. Like, maybe Channel 8 had their cameras in there that day or somebody.
Or were we, like, live streaming the whole
maybe.
White Elephant or
Who
something
can
like
say.
That? Anyway, so I wanted to ask him about it.
An influence in his getting that job with the Browns.
So have you taken a shot at anybody in a while?
I'll see you guys. Have a nice time.
Oh, hey, Coach.
You know, that's to tell you the truth, that's not even funny to me. And I think you guys would be a little bit beyond crap like that.
All right. Well, we appreciate Bob Knight joining us here on Sports Radio 1310. The Ticket, again, Tech and Stanford, December 22nd at the AAC.
Oh, we had him on for Tech and Stanford. Yeah. That's right.
And then he was never heard on the station
Yeah,
again.
You know what? The show might have been done by then. That might have been a one-off after the fact, now that I think of it.
I think so. It had to have been.
Yeah.
I got called into the office because they had bought like $5,000 worth of advertising on the station, you know, and they wanted an apology. Tim Knight or Pat Knight or whoever wanted demanded an apology, and I'm just like, probably not, man. It's probably not going to happen.
Well, this is where we have to remind all the voters that it isn't really about voting somebody into...
We're not voting him into heaven.
...sainthood or heaven. We're simply trying to see, did his life matter? And of course it did. He's in.
I'm going to...
Oh, shut up.
I'm going to just... I'm going to sit this one out and say...
This could be the end of the trifecta if we're not willing to vote in a guy in every Hall of Fame.
Is there a purgatory waiting room at Trifecta Lakes?
We can't start trying their lives. This is...
I'll vote him into Trifecta Hell.
This is so dumb. We've changed the rules on the fly.
Can we guarantee that he doesn't end up at Trifecta Lakes... He's in the trifecta hell. Didn't we do it with some other bad people?
Yeah, and it's a bad precedent to do this.
Why? He's a horrible human.
Well, everyone's a horrible human.
They're not.
DJ, who would he be sharing a room with?
Matthew Perry.
No! We can't have that happen. No, out.
We're ruining the bit.
No, we're not.
All right, he's in, Bob.
Well, I'm not. Look, I'm not.
I'm campaigning for him.
The trifecta as a bit has been one
we
way for 20 years. Evidently, we do. Now we are deciding.
So it's 2-2. We have Lando and DJ left to vote.
Go ahead, Lando.
What, did you vote against it?
I did.
Like, he's not
principal.
Trifecta worthy.
No, principle alone.
Don't we have Pat Robertson in trifecta hell?
We do.
Understanding that Bob Knight is a D, he was a great basketball coach, and I'll put him in.
Okay.
Okay, DJ?
I won't be bullied by Bob. He's out.
Wow, so it's a tie.
You don't have to be. It isn't
so
being
he isn't
bullied.
It's so trifecta Lakes purgatory.
I wasn't even on the hard line when this bit started, and it was a certain way for decades. And now we're just deciding not to recognize people that we didn't like.
All right, we'll take one P1.
It's the dumbest thing we've ever done.
We'll take a P1 call to decide things coming up next. All right, so we were reminded in the break that on June 14th, 2023, that we created something at Trifecta Lakes called The Hole. In which people that were notorious, they were obviously going to get in because of their notoriety,
yeah,
but they were bad, were put in the hole.
Yeah, they don't,
and they didn't get
they
a
don't
suite.
Deserve a an ensuite room.
Yeah, right, with the likes of Matthew Perry. And so far, in the hole, and the hole is endless. It's got unlimited room down there.
Yeah.
In the hole is Ted Kaczynski, the Unabomber, the Iron Sheik, and Pat Robertson. So we're trying to figure out if Bob Knight is going to be in the hole. We had a 3-3 vote at the end of Trifecta, whether or not he deserves to be with Matthew Perry. Something to think about. Matthew had a very tough life.
Yeah.
Right. He doesn't need that
type
of...
He doesn't need to be driven to drink.
Beratement, yes, to do more drugs. So let's go to the phones. Let's take a phone call. Let's see if we can break this tie. Hello, sir. You're on the air.
Hello, Hardline. How are you?
We're good. How are you?
I'm a little torn, but I think Bob Knight gets in. But I don't like that he's with Matthew Perry.
Yeah, I know. That's the problem we had.
I have a question since I was on break for so long. DJ was very nice, but... I started thinking, the three bedroom apartment Mike Leach is in.
Yeah.
Who is he with, and would anybody want to move out?
Okay.
Yeah. See, we haven't really thought about moving rooms and things like that. I mean, it would be handy to put coach with coach, but yeah, I don't think it works that way. But he's going to put him in. So that elevates him into Matthew Perry's room.
All right.
Officially.
He avoided the hole.
He's out of the hole. I love, dude, the concept of the hole is great, though.
Yeah, but how is Iron Sheik, like.
We don't know.
How did any of this happen?
We don't know, but I love the hole. It's a super awesome concept.
And here he is, Dave.
All right, we have a lot to try to get to. Before we get into Matthew Perry tributes, couple of Hollywood quick hits. Jimmy Kimmel is coming back as host of the Oscars. He said that he's always dreamed of hosting the Oscars exactly four times.
Okay.
And so that will be his legacy, as he has hosted in 2017, 2018, and 2023. So he will get another back-to-back. And the 96th Oscars will be on March 10th of next year.
All right.
And they have also announced casting for the reboot of the Fantastic Four.
So, man, the Fantastic Four that was rebooted, didn't it have, what's his name from the Chiklis? Wasn't he Mr. Rockman?
Thing?
He was a Thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, but those, I guess, are before the Fantastic Four became part of the MCU.
Oh,
they are
okay.
Now part of the MCU, so all of that, just wipe it from your memory. It
didn't
doesn't
happen.
Exist.
Their credit
happen.
Hours transferred.
Yeah.
And so they did have the Fantastic Four, or at least Mr. Fantastic, in Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness. It was, you know, an alternate dimension, and it was John Krasinski.
Didn't he get killed?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was kind of, I mean, spoiler alert, it was kind of like a bait and switch. Like,
right.
Oh my God, look, they're announcing this new casting, and oh, he's dead.
Yeah.
But yeah, so they have announced that Pedro Pascal will be Mr. Fantastic. And of course, Mr. Fantastic.
What's his bit?
He was exposed to radiation And so that means that he basically turned into Stretch Armstrong.
Oh, yeah.
He can stretch his limbs, and he can trampoline stuff back where it came.
And is there a girl involved in this in the Fantastic Four?
Yeah, there's
Sue Storm.
Sue Storm, Johnny Storm, and Ben Grimm, a.k.a. The Thing. So there's the Invisible Woman, the Human Torch, the Thing, and Mr. Fantastic.
I think I'm out on that.
Yeah, I mean, it's not going to come out until May of 2025, so you
have time to play.
You have time to not care.
Good.
Time to work your calendar around.
All right. As far as tributes to Matthew Perry, there was the group tribute.
Yep.
And then yesterday, we heard from Matt LeBlanc, and he was the first to post his own tribute. Then also yesterday, Courtney Cox, after we went off the air, she posted a tribute. And she posted a clip from the episode of the one with Ross's wedding, when they went to England for Ross's wedding.
And that's the first time they slept together,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, and then Chandler and Monica hooked up. And so she posted a clip of when Ross comes into Chandler's room and Monica's under the covers,
right.
And then Ross leaves and he
like,
pulls
back. Do you think
back
he had any idea?
Yeah,
or whatever?
Did he know I was in here? And then she posted an outtake where he had fed her a line. So after the applause dies down, she says, "Okay, your turn," and basically shoves his head under the sheets. she wrote, you know, that I'm grateful for every moment I had with Maddie. Miss you every day. When you work with someone as closely as I did, there are thousands of moments I wish I could share. And for now, here's one of my favorites. And so she posted that. And then that was followed today by Jennifer Aniston and David Schwimmer. So Jennifer Aniston wrote, "This one's cut deep. Having to say goodbye to our Maddie has been an insane wave of emotions I've never experienced before. Being able to really sit in this grief allows you to feel the moments of joy and gratitude, having loved someone that deeply." And then she said, "I've been poring over our texts to one another, laughing and crying and laughing again. I'll keep them forever." And then she posted a screen grab of one of them where he reads, "Making you laugh just made my day every time." And it was a picture of the two of them at like a table reading, going over a script and just dying laughing, like leaning into each other. And then David Schwimmer, this is pretty funny too. He said, "Maddie, thank you for 10 incredible years of laughter and creativity." And then he posted a photo from the Thanksgiving episode from season 5, the one with all the Thanksgivings was the name of the episode. And in the photo, it's a flashback sequence, I guess, and he and Matthew Perry are wearing Miami Vice style suits, like the white suits with the pastel shirts. And he says, "This photo's one of my favorite moments with you. Now it makes me smile and grieve at the same time." And then he thinks about, you know, Matthew in heaven or Trifecta Lakes, as it were. He says, "I imagine you up there somewhere in the same white suit, hands in your pockets, looking around. Could there be any more clouds?"
So, all right. I'm glad they all waited. You know, like we were saying yesterday, they needed time to kind of gather
Lisa
their thoughts.
Lisa Kudrow, still waiting on her.
Yeah.
What's her deal?
I don't know. What is her deal? This is big news, as Sammy Hagar and Michael Anthony are teaming up with Joe Satriani and Jason Bonham for a summer tour calling The Best of All Worlds. And they're focusing on the music of Van Halen. I'm sure they'll sprinkle in some Chicken Foot and some Sammy Hagar solo.
Three Lock Box.
Yeah. And then Lover Boy is going to be opening up.
Lover Boy?
Yeah. Yeah.
Where'd they dig them out of?
But Hagar and...
No disrespect.
Are they working for Sammy, the weekend?
Sammy Hagar and Michael Anthony and Satriani were in Chicken Foot, if you recall.
Yeah, Chicken Foot so didn't really resonate.
It's basically Chicken Foot plus Jason Bonham. But when they did Chicken Foot, they never played Eddie Van Halen. So this is Satriani's first chance to play Eddie Van Halen stuff. And if there's anybody that can replicate or at least reproduce in their own style the guitar wizardry of Eddie Van Halen, it's Joe Satriani, right? Or maybe Steve Vai could do it too.
Yeah.
But what
if Michael Anthony breaks out his bass of the Jack Daniels bottle?
No, right? There's no doubt
he will.
It's
going to be awesome.
Yeah.
And
you should go.
I will go.
I don't believe you.
You should stop looking down at Van Halen.
So Hagar is who I look down at.
They all appeared on the Howard Stern show.
I'm the one that just saw Sammy Hagar live in concert, not you.
Begrudgingly.
Well,
you tried to turn you turned your back on the stage the entire time.
Because he played with the Killers.
So on the appearance on the Howard Stern show, Sammy said that this tour is a celebration of not just Van Hagar, but all of Van Halen. And he extended the invitation to David Lee Roth and Alex Van Halen, who they've had a falling out with Alex. They don't talk anymore. But he said that any point along the way on the tour that they are both invited to join on stage and play with them, he said, we're going to invite every musician in every town, other guitar players, we'll get them involved, other singers, we'll get them involved. If Alex wants to jump out, if David Lee Roth wants to come join us, come on, MF-er, you're welcome. This is about Van Halen.
Okay.
So if you want to circle a couple of dates, okay. August 22nd at Dos Equis Pavilion here in Dallas.
Oh, that should be nice and cool.
And, well, if that's too hot for
you. Those guys are like 80 and they're playing in 100-degree weather.
They are not.
If 80. That's too hot for you, August 11th at Red Rocks.
Going in.
All right.
I'm not going to allow that to be your first Red Rocks show. I'm just not.
All right.
How old is Sammy Hagar? I said 80. Well, how old do you think he is?
He's got to be like 78, right?
Yeah, he's probably getting there.
76.
76. There you go.
All right. A couple of funny quick hits or amusing quick hits to end E! News today. There is a new musical that is going to debut in London this December. It's called Gwyneth Goes Skiing.
Oh, is this a takeoff on her lawsuit?
Yes. It's by a theater called the they describe themselves as the Harbingers of Queer Chaos. They're called Awkward Productions. And so the log line of Gwyneth Goes Skiing says, she's the goop-founding, door-sliding, Shakespearean-loving, consciously uncoupling Hollywood superstar. He's a retired optometrist from Utah. In 2016, they went skiing. On the slopes of Deer Valley, their worlds collided, and so did they. Literally. Ouch. 7 years later, in 2023, they went to court. Double ouch. This is their story. Kind of. Not really. But also, it's at Christmas.
Okay, the only thing that I remember about that trial is that she's up there all weepy. And was like,
she lost a half day skiing.
What was the worst thing about this for you? Well, I lost a half day of skiing.
Yeah, so might be amusing.
Didn't sound tone deaf at all.
No.
And also, Jada Pinkett Smith has said that she and Will Smith are going to be suing his former assistant, Brother Bilal, because Brother Bilal, a couple days ago, was on a podcast. And he claimed that he opened the door to Fresh Prince of Bel-Air co-star Dwayne Martin's room, his dressing room, and saw Dwayne having Granal Grex with Will Smith.
Whoa.
And he also said that Smith's manhood looked like a pinky toe.
Well, when was he talking about this?
On a podcast 2 days ago.
Like, literally, you're allowed to just... I guess you're not allowed to do that. You're going to get lawsuit.
Yeah, well, yeah. He's going to get sued. So, Will Smith denied having sex with his co-star, saying that the claims are
like, you know,
completely fabricated. But that's always been the hot rumor, that Will is really gay and that Jada Pinkett Smith is his beard.
Right.
And so this,
you better realize, though, that
I know,
there's a lot of money involved with those people.
You can't just go out and say whatever you want without consequences.
Yeah.
So we'll see where that goes.
All right, Dave, thank you very much.
Get the Steak Podcast at patreon.com/sportsgreek.
Quick follow-up to a previous community quick hit. If you remember the murder at Sonic, where the 12-year-old shot the Sonic employee with an AR-15 rifle back in May.
Went back to his car to retrieve it from his dad's car? Or?
Yeah, it was his uncle, yes. Yeah. That his 20-year-old uncle, Angel Gomez, got into a fight with 32-year-old Matt Davis, who was the Sonic employee, and they were getting into a fist fight because the employee busted Angel Gomez for urinating in the parking lot.
Yeah.
And so while they were fighting, the 12-year-old went to the truck, got out the AR-15 rifle, and shot the Sonic employee and killed him. Well, he was sentenced today. The boy is now 13, and he was ordered to the custody of the Texas Juvenile Justice Department with possible transfer to the Texas Department of Criminal Justice for a term of 12 years.
Yeah, not to be like a jerk, but he should never get out of jail. And I imagine when he gets out of jail, if he does, he'll do something awful again and he'll end up right back in there. You know the difference between right and wrong as a 12-year-old. You can't kill people like that.
Well, maybe he just thought he was defending his uncle.
Whatever.
What a controversial rule you've laid down for the 12-year-olds of America.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, look. I mean, he's going to get out in 12 years. He'll be 24 and be like, all right, let's go. Can I go to college? Maybe I've got some eligibility left to play some basketball.
Yeah, well, maybe he'll get, like, an associate's degree in the clink, and then he can go straight to Clemson and be a quarterback.
I'm kind of shocked.
That guy is headed to the slammer.
It's 12 years. When you guys were kids, weren't you under the impression that
you go to juvie until
like
you're 18?
Your 18th birthday, and then they set you free no matter what?
I think maybe murder, it's a little bit different. Oh, you killed someone?
No, but you know my background.
The Frank story?
No, this is not Frank. This is another guy at the school that killed his dad. We've talked about
Hank. Yeah.
And I swear he got out on his 18th birthday.
It may be different as we've aged.
Dude,
but
that was...
And did he do bad things after that? Do y'all know?
No, I don't know that, but the act itself, I want to say 7th grade, shotgun, dad.
Yeah.
Don't like what dad's telling me, so let me end dad right here. I mean,
spend 6 years and I'm good.
Maybe not even.
Oh, my God.
Worth it.
It's just, I didn't understand how that worked, but I thought that was pretty tried and true. So you're saying a 12-year-old until at least 24.
It doesn't say whether or not he has the opportunity to get out before 12 years, but he was sentenced to 12 years.
Okay.
So I have
no idea. Well, it sounds like we've adjusted the system and probably properly.
Okay, here is a fascinating story. File this under what could go wrong. So there's a company in Deep Ellum called Colossal Biosciences.
This sounds like a place where you get your head cut off and frozen.
No, not quite. So Matt James is there. He is their chief animal officer. And he says, we are creating technology that's going to change tomorrow with de-extinction. But what's amazing is that these technologies are making a difference to endangered species conservation today. So what they are doing, they're using DNA from Asian elephants and DNA recovered from woolly mammoths that were frozen in Arctic tundra. And Jurassic Park style, they are mashing up the genomes to try and re-engineer the genome of an Asian elephant until it becomes a woolly mammoth.
All right. Mammoths are cool, right? Like, I've seen Ice Age.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the last woolly mammoth was died 4,000 years ago. They have not walked the earth for 4,000 years. But they are 99.6% similar to Asian elephants. So they just got to make up that 0.4% gap.
I think we need Jeff Goldblum's take on this.
Yeah, so they say that they expect to be successful by 2028. That's their goal, to put a mammoth on the moon.
Okay, what is an Asian elephant? Does it resemble? You said it's 90-whatever percent.
99.4%.
Yeah. Like, it's
six.
Not that far off. So do they look like mammoths?
I don't know. Look up an Asian elephant.
Well, why are you yelling at me?
You asked the question.
But you're the story master. Let's see. Asian.
So they are saying that if they can resurrect mammoths, that...
they look like elephants.
That they can help preserve the permafrost, which is part of the issue with global warming. The permafrost... in the Arctic areas is melting.
Yeah.
And for some reason, I guess that mammoths will help that stop melting. I have no idea. But
I would love to hear more about this.
It says it will slow the release of greenhouse gases. I thought maybe they were going to like start farming them. Like,
right.
We're going to start eating de-extinct mammoth. Like, you could go to Bob's Steak and Chop House and get a mammoth steak?
Like, yeah. A mammoth,
I like steak.
The way that I envision it is hairy.
Yeah.
Woolly, if you will. With the giant tusks.
Yes, exactly.
The elephant, the Asian elephant that I've now studied for over 30 seconds, looks like your American elephant. Or African elephant. Elephant.
What is an American... What is an African-American element?
I would love to hear all of this. Please break down the elephants by ethnicity.
I'm just saying, I'm now the expert on this, as I've now Googled both. So I'm just telling you what I'm seeing.
Well, what's the difference?
Asian
sumo versus an African elephant. Like, one just has a
what
bigger
was that,
hog.
Bob?
The Asian elephant is better at sumo.
Okay. Dave, I'm not even going to answer whatever your question was.
He also says that they have plans to resurrect the dodo bird and the Tasmanian tiger.
I love it all.
Oh, I thought he was going to say the Tasmanian devil, which was my favorite of all the Looney Tunes characters.
Absolutely.
Yes, like, the Tasmanian
tiger. How did that ever make the cut? Like, who came up with the Tasmanian devil?
The best brain ever.
Seriously, it's so genius.
That he just spins in a circle and goes...
Right, you just see a little hand poking out every now and then in the circle.
Joining us now is the Tasmanian devil.
Not bad.
I love it. We have something here.
All right, and that is your community quick hits.
Yeah.
A shorty, because we spent some quality time with Pete DeBoer.
DJ didn't want to
Elephant
have fun.
Biogenesis that's in Dallas?
Yeah, they have a headquarters in Deep Ellum.
Deep
Colossal
Ellum?
Biosciences. Right. Maybe we'll take a field trip. Maybe they'll buy a remote, and we can try some mammoth steak.
It all sounds good.
Yeah, in theory, for sure.